Hi, Babushka. I'm going to be sending you a little care package in, at 2 days away tops. Probably tomorrow when I finish work. But yeah, I'm sending you homemade candy. So I made peanut butter fudge and almond brittle with a touch of vanilla. And then I tried a new candy. It's a chocolate brittle. And it turned out pretty good. This coworker of mine, she just took off to South Carolina because she has her family over there, even though she's helping her daughter and her grandson over here in Washington State. So her mom is Jehovah Witness, and they're very particular about gift giving and stuff like that. So last Christmas time, around the holidays, I made some candy for this coworker of mine, Sean. And Sean, if you're out there, hello. Can't wait till you come back. But her mother really enjoyed it. They don't celebrate holidays the way a lot of other people do, and that's all right. It's a good thing. To me, holidays should be every day, and they can be whatever you want them to be. So there you go. But yeah, chocolate brittle turned out pretty darn good. Very good. Very good with some cranberry tea. So, on that note, I wanted to talk to you a little bit more about your grandfather, John. I loved him a lot. And after mom died, as I was saying in the last video, him and I, we had a lot of stuff to discuss and hash out. So, I don't know if your sister ever sent you a copy of this photo here. But the guy in the Navy uniform, well, that's your grandfather and his two siblings. He had a younger sister and an even younger brother. And that's their mom, Esther, the other Esther. I had two grandmothers named Esther. So I'll talk about this Esther, who I never knew because she died way too young. But I'll discuss that in a future video because it leads to this, my arguments with your grandfather and why they had to manifest the way they did, why they had to happen. And why we kept a lot of this stuff secret, not to be discussed with the other family members, with my siblings and whatnot. There was just no way. Speaking about candy, your great grandfather, my mom's father, Ed. He actually was the one who taught me how to make candy at a young age. It started with peanut brittle. That was his thing. Very particular about it and strict, especially because it gets really hot. Hot to temperature, it can burn you. And I used to watch him make it, and I would pay real close attention to all his rules and cautions on how to make it successfully. But that can be another story. I loved your grandfather. Going back to John here, I loved my father very much. I would visit him periodically. My guardian, Gina, she didn't want me to do it. But then again, she kind of did, because he agreed, and it was in the divorce settlement anyways between my parents, that he provide health coverage for me and whatnot, and to continue with the child support, the regular payments. Now, as far as past payment dues went, the arrears, my guardian, she wanted me to sign paperwork to have him court ordered to kind of gut it out of him. And in my mind, that was going to distract, trying to rekindle a relationship with my dad, He was going through a lot of pain, maybe looking back at some of the mistakes that he had made, along with grieves that he went through. That's one thing. He didn't teach me how to make candy. He taught me a thing about redundancy. He was known to rant, and he was known to grieve. And looking back, a lot of people thought it had to do with his situation of going through post-polio syndrome. That is how it is correctly said. You don't say how that person went through polio. It's a syndrome, it's the aftermath. It's a neurological disease, basically, and it's the aftermath of having the polio virus. The ranting had, in my opinion, a lot to do with past trauma that he went through in his life. And he grew up in a certain area. And it was a certain generation as well in Oregon where a lot of his desires deep down within him could not be met. Yeah, he played football. That was something he was really good at doing. And it was w a wonderful thing in his life back when he was young in the 1930s before he enlisted in the Navy. At the tail end of World War II, it was a good thing that he got that scholarship to go over to Arizona. He was a guard for a private school, like I was saying before, and then he ended up playing some college football back in the day for the University of New Mexico. He wore the old school football uniforms, mostly cotton, with like a leather helmet and a pigskin football. He had a lot of stories about those times and, going to those bigger schools at that time. Phoenix was a booming town back then in the 1930s and, early 40s. It was probably about the population that Salem, Oregon was when your granddad and I would have these conversations. So back in the 80s. And it was a way for him to get away and to hang out with the friends that he wanted to hang out with. And he had a few friends, one in particular, who went with him on the same scholarship. But anywho, I'm visiting him. My guardians don't like it. My guardian's husband has nothing but disdain for, my dad. And he was not one to talk. My dad was known, at least privately, of being a social drinker. He was also a crying drinker. That was how he made it through the day, this and that. It was something kind of ignored. Now, when my parents first met, and my mother did tell me this before she died, when they would go to taverns or get-togethers or parties, she would have one drink with him, one cocktail, usually something, you know, like a Cape Cod or something, vodka with cranberry or what have you, or, you know, vodka with grapefruit juice. But then, this was a mistake that she made. She would tell the bartender, you know, later on, because Dad would want her to keep drinking, she would sneakily tell the bartender, put 7-Up in it, you know, or seltzer water instead of the alcohol, and just charge it as a regular drink. Yeah, not a good thing. But, you know, Mom loved him for whatever reason. She loved his stories. She loved his endearment. She loved his strength, at least in the beginning. And I think she was always hoping that things would continue on rather than addressing the problem. She wanted it to kind of play out and work its way out. But then things happened so fast during the downfall of their marriage. It was good that they divorced, but the outcome and everything was totally wrong, and that was part of the arguments. I couldn't explain it to my guardian or her husband. Couldn't at all, because my guardian's husband was a worse drinker. When I moved down to Houston, south of Salem, away from my beloved Burnside. Actually, before I had moved, at my guardian's wedding, I met her husband's nephew, or at least one of them. He was in the wedding party, and I also met a niece who was a stepbrother. She was not in the party, but she was partying, and she had a date with her who was an older guy. But I was introduced to this young man named Jason, who had been living and was just getting ready to graduate from the high school there in Houston. You know, small towns. When you go to a wedding in a small town, and a lot of people, at least on one side, might be related to each other. That's the joke about cousins meeting cousins. You got nothing better to do. You might as well hook up and start dating. Well, I met this guy, this young boy. I think he was just turning 18. And I was 15 going on 16 at the time. We hit it off. We immediately started to date. We immediately started kind of a relationship. And then he enlisted in the Navy. He sent me his naval ring as a promise ring. And in the society I lived in, both high schools, and the small town especially of Humbleton, it was quite common for young people to start courting very early, even as early as 13, 14 years old, depending on what society, what group of people, what culture. It was a big deal for young women, for young teenage girls, to have an engagement ring on their finger. And like I was saying, my brain was in a lot of grief and in a lot of shock. Well, this young man, Jason, he drove me all over Houston and showed me around before he left to go into the Navy. And I was thinking that it was a new beginning. And I thought, okay, we can have this relationship. And maybe if I go to homecoming or the prom, he can get time off, get some leave, and then take me. Or I can just end up going with friends. No big deal. He did tell me, though, immediately, that his uncle, we're going to call him Bert, because he kind of reminds me of Burt Reynolds in one of his earlier films, Deliverance, that kind of cocky character. Jason told me that Bert was a drinker and that nobody talked about it and everybody loved him and accepted him for who he was and that that's the way it is. And that's the way it's going to be. I think he brought it up when I questioned it. Because the man would drink almost 24/7. Even when he was driving. And it was always cheap wine. Cheaper than what my father drank. He'd always have to be the center of attention. And he'd always be loved by all of his nieces and nephews. At least at that time. So, this is about 1988 or so. I wanted to visit my father, and I did. Almost every weekend or every other weekend before I got my waitressing job. When I started my waitressing job, he started visiting me. But the argument. The second big blowout we had. I think it began when I was at his house, at my old house in Humbleton. Like I was telling you before, the house was built in 1900. A lot of the features in it, it had nothing really modern in it. Not for 1980s standards at all. And he was cheap. He was a skinflint. But a lot of the, say the electrical fixtures, were so old school. We had those old school light bulbs that would hang, you know, by a wire. And then you'd, you know, pull the little thing and it'd turn on. Like something out of an old Warner Brothers cartoon. And the bathroom, the light fixture in there. Well, number one, there was no shower. It was just an old bathtub. No curtain, no nothing. So if you needed privacy, you had to figure out a way to lock the door. But the way the electrical setup was made, say if you were brushing your teeth or washing your hands and you needed to open up the bathroom cabinet, if the water in the sink was on, you would electrocute yourself just by touching the little metal edge of the cupboard. Made it hard for me when I would want to brush my teeth, stuff like that. But I remember using the bathroom and washing my hands and looking in the mirror and looking all around me and looking at that damn cabinet and how I was always afraid to touch it because it might shock me. My father always treated it like it was no big deal. You know, just be careful. Do it this way. Do it that way. I bitched about it. He was nearby in his bedroom. I think he was taking off his shoes and then taking off his braces to get his slippers on. And he was getting prepared, you know, to just walk with his canes without his braces. It was safe that way in the house. To go into the living room so him and I could sit and talk or he could read the paper, what have you. He talked to me about school and stuff, but it just turned into an argument. I bitched about the setup of the house, I bitched about what happened with Mom. I bitched about the hypocrisy of that town. And I bitched about how my friend Consuelo and some of my other Mexican friends were being treated. Now, your granddad was what I would consider, and especially in that community and communities around it, and this is Oregon now. They always think that Oregon is just a shiny, wonderful place. When they do television shows and whatnot, it's mostly stuff in Portland or down in Eugene, you know? There's a lot of sugar-coated racism. It's actually, if you look at it historically, one of the founding issues, one of the problems when Oregon became a state with those settlers. And I'll tell you about that later. But my dad started to argue with me, like it was an okay thing. And I'm like, how can you use the S word? Now, that's a racist word that I will not say on video, and I hate it. Or the B word, you know, about Mexican Americans, you know, Hispanics in general. It's a terrible thing. It's dehumanizing. But I would tell him straight to his face, you should know better. You know, there's bad words that people use against people like us. What the hell is your problem? And that's another thing, too. He cussed a lot. I know this is kind of gauche to say this, but one of his favorite terms was God Almighty or God Damn It. With his polio and everything, looking back at it now, it was almost as if he were a chanting shaman in times of prayer and chanting when it came to him using cuss words. You know, all that filth coming out of his mouth. And I have, as you know, I can have a dirty mouth too. But I'm careful, or a lot more careful than what I used to be, having a potty mouth. I would cuss back at him. And you know, your uncles, they would too. But they were much worse than me. But I would call him on stuff. And in this incident, I'm like, how can you even talk that way? And I'm like, you got a thing for those Mexican women. How can you dehumanize something that you like? And it caught him off guard, because we're going to go back in time here when I was a little girl and I would hang out with him, maybe sit on his lap or sit next to him, and I would grab like old high school yearbooks or books with photos in it and show them to him. And he would identify people and tell me about his life, about his days in high school, and his days when he went to that private school in Arizona, and then his friends, and who he would hang out with, and all his stories about going out with his buddies. I asked him about his girlfriends. Did you date? Who'd you like? Who's that girl right there? I would look at the photos in these books, and he would point out who he dated. I dated this girl here. I took this girl to this dance, or I would hang out with these group of people. Okay. I noticed as a child, the girls that he hung out with and dated the most were all Mexican. and one was light-skinned black. She was the only girl, actually, at that particular school. You know, it's a private school out in Arizona. It doesn't exist anymore, but it was a big thing back then. But she was the only black girl at that school. So I called him on it. And I said, you know, it's okay to like mocha. Mocha's a beautiful thing. I like mocha too. I think all flavors are wonderful. And it caught him off guard. He started arguing with me, you know, doing the whole Archie Bunker hypocrisy stuff. I played it right back at him. And we continued to argue and continued to argue and continued to go at each other. And then we would break down and cry some more. I think, as I thought back then, but I didn't know how to put it in certain terms like I can now. I think that living out there far away granted him a lot of freedoms that he didn't have at home. And you fall in love or you're attracted to who you're attracted to. And that's another thing too, I called him on it. He loved reading books. You know, like back in the day, Mom, your grandma, she would read a lot of Harlequin romance novels. It was a big to-do for generations back in the day. Your grandfather, he loved reading books regarding Native American women or Hispanic women or black women, but especially the Native women during the pioneer days. One book that he sought after, and he actually read about it in the paper, and he couldn't wait till the book came out, and some of his buddies were talking about it too, was a book about the life of Sacagawea. And I think it was a thick book too. I think he must have read it like 3 times. So I questioned him on this stuff. I think as a teenager, away from his family, away from his grandparents who raised him, especially Grandma Isabella, he was able to escape down there and be himself. And why not? I remember talking to some of the women in the community much later on, after I moved up here to Seattle. One woman in particular who ended up buying and rebuilding that old house. Her husband's a millionaire and owns a large mill up in Alaska. She happened to be a little bit younger than your grandfather when they were, you know, teenagers and whatnot. And I would ask her questions. She actually spent a couple of days with me here in Seattle when I was pregnant with you. Grandfather did not date any white girls. A lot of the girls liked him. But this woman, not knowing what she was really explaining to me, told me that he didn't date so-and-so or such-and-such or such-and-such, that he was just a friendly guy. Well, from the stories your grandfather would tell me, he would go to places with girls. He would date lots of girls. And a lot of his friends, the groups that he hung out with, the guys. There were guys, you know, who were cousins of his, but he had a lot of Mexican friends, and they would meet up, and they'd go to the movie houses together, you know, Salem or Portland, what have you, and then over in Arizona. And he would get introduced to so-and-so, you know, this is my sister, or this is my cousin, this young lady over here. And then also at school. A funny thing. We would break down together. We would cry and hug each other. And then at times, we'd go out to eat. And he would start to let loose a little bit. He would behave around me. The ranting would subside. Sometimes I'd kind of see him staring off at a wall or out in the distance, something, staring at something, probably contemplating and thinking about the terrible outcome of his ex-wife, you know, someone whom he loved. There would be a Chinese restaurant in particular that we loved going to up in Newgate, where I was born. We would drink our tea together, we'd have our food, but then we'd get to talking, and he'd be real comfortable around me. Sometimes he'd be talking so much, and I would be listening, because I loved listening to his stories. The food would actually start to get cold. And that was okay. You know, we would slowly eat it, and sometimes we would actually close the restaurant down. It's no big deal. I'd be at his place for the weekend. And your Uncle Eddie at the time, he was just finishing high school in Humbleton, or he'd be out on the weekends with his friends. He'd be away from the house. So there was some peace there, with nobody else there to listen, nobody else to disrupt and take over the conversation. So we could have some precious times, and I could really focus on him. It's a lot of healing that I needed to go through, and at the time, like I said before, I was really numb. I was happy in the beginning, living with my guardian, Gina. Before I moved over there, this is going back a little bit here, during the transition, it was around the holidays. As your grandmother, Sarah, the date that she died was November 5th. So I had the first Thanksgiving with my guardian and her husband and his family. Big to do. And boy, did they love bomb me in the beginning. Then she'd take me out shopping at the mall, have me pick out clothes. She's like, pick out anything, whatever you want, a blouse, slacks, boots, what have you. And I thought, well, this is cool. This is great. Why not? Then Christmas rolls around. Christmas is good. Decent gifts and what have you. It was all right. I was still real numb. And my guardian and her husband and their family is all Catholic. And I'm trying to go back to the Catholic Church, be with that group of people, see what it's like. I wasn't happy about any of the kids that went there either. They seem like a popular crowd. But I remember after a month's time, after Christmas, of living there, one day my guardian approached me. And I think she was angry because I wouldn't sign that paperwork that would confirm to the courts that my dad owed all that back child support. She told me, and this is so funny, because she's has a lot of Native American and her family background, mixed with the French Canadian. I had always heard the term, which is a terrible term, called Indian giver. But she told me that I owed her money for all those gifts she bought me. And I was in shock. I was a minor. You know, she's supposed to be my parent figure. And I thought, wow, why? Well, she was thinking about the money. And she was being vindictive. And even after promises, because she had known me since I was a baby, after promises to Mom to be there for me and to help raise me in case something went down, you know, to rear me, I don't think she knew exactly what she was getting into. And also, her best friend, who happened to be her husband's sister, big family, about, you know, five of them, including my guardian's husband, Bert. But the sister was going to a school nearby, Houston, a college, very well known for degrees in teaching and psychology. Well, this friend, she was majoring in psychology or psychiatry, I don't know. But she really wanted to push me into getting on medication, like Prozac. She was like, you know, you're depressed. I'm like, I'm not depressed. I'm healing. I don't know what I am now. She wanted to push that stuff on me. And something in my head told me not to do it. That the way I could heal through this, and who knew how long it would take. It was going to take talking and listening and finding the right people to help me down this path. Because as you know, I'm a lightweight. I can't handle alcohol. There's no way. I can't handle drugs at all. You know? I think a little bit of nicotine, one cigarette a day, and I know you hate that, and I'm so sorry. I know. When we meet in the future, I promise that will not be around you at all. Okay? Totally cool. And, you know, if you want to smoke a little weed around me, hey, that's fine. That's your business. That's your right. But a little nicotine and a little caffeine, that's all I really need. And just looking at going back to my dad and then looking at my guardian's husband, I'm glad I made certain decisions that I made. I'm proud to be a teetotaler. It's a good thing. Yeah, that's another old-timey term. And, you know, your grandfather would use that term a lot as a way to kind of tease people or ridicule them, which I think is really wrong. But I'm going to wind up this video and we'll go more into that. So yeah, in maybe a few days, expect a nice little package in the mail. And don't forget, sweetheart, to ring the bell for me, and I'll talk to you later, okay? I love you very much. I gotta feed Gus too. And I hope your kitty cats are doing good. Love you. Take care.